At the most general level, the way I describe the condition we're in is that it's as if we're driving a car at night, and we're driving it fast, and we're outrunning the range of our headlights. And we believe that somewhere out there's a cliff that we could drive over. We have a choice. Do we keep stepping on the accelerator, or do we ease off and start hitting the brakes? The climate problem has shaped up somewhat like what we anticipated 20 years ago. I think the major difference is the effects actually became detectable, scientifically observable, and documented a decade or two sooner in some cases than we had envisioned. In other cases, things happened that we hadn't envisioned at all. For instance, the large and rapid decrease in the Arctic sea ice pack. So the piece of the puzzle that I focus most on is the sea level rise problem. And the part of the sea level rise problem that I focus my energies on is what contribution will the large ice sheets in Greenland and particularly Antarctica eventually make to sea level rise? There's enough in just the 10% of Antarctica called the West Antarctic Ice Sheet to raise sea level ultimately by about 5 meters or about 17 feet. And then there's enough ice in East Antarctica to give you water world to raise sea level by about 57 meters. So slowing the rate of sea level rise and eventually stabilizing the situation by preventing the ice sheets from disintegrating. That's one thing that I have as a personal mission. How do we develop policies that can do that? We took a bunch of influential people on essentially a floating tour around Svalbard, which is an archipelago that's far north of Norway, at the edge of the permanent sea ice, and showed them both the incredibly diverse, biologically rich resources up there. I mean, polar bears and whales and seals and birds, just in a density that's not easy to find in other places of the world. While at the same time starting to show them some of the changes that are beginning to occur due to global warming. And I think one way to get policymakers to understand what's going on is just to look for those aspects of this problem that are like other problems, and then a few aspects that are very different and highlight those. And I like to use the success that we had against air pollution, against acid rain, against the threat of ozone depletion as examples of what's possible when you combine political will, technological progress, and the ability to learn how to actually make comprehensive change. We've done it before, we can do it again. Global warming is the biggest challenge we've faced environmentally yet, but it's a challenge that can be dealt with. It's a problem that can be solved. That's why my optimism, I think, finds some actual basis in reality.